For years, China has dominated the market for rare earth elements, which are used in all kinds of modern technology. But now, China's grip on the market might be slipping. Welcome to China Uncensored. I'm Chris Chappell. The Chinese Communist Party has made China so essential to Western supply chains that even if the West wanted to decouple economically, it would be very difficult and possibly risky. Case in point, rare earth elements. Rare earth elements are used for things like cell phones, computers, and electric vehicles, and China controls most of the market for them. Analysis by the International Energy Agency suggests China accounts for 60% of global rare earth extraction and 87% of processing. This is a big problem because in addition to tech we use every day, they're used in a lot of critical military technology as well. We did an episode about the US military buying F-35 fighter jets from Lockheed Martin that had rare earth metals from China in them. The military basically said, yeah, it's bad to be using Chinese materials, but not bad enough we're not going to use them. So it granted them a waiver and gave Lockheed Martin a slap on the wrist. My favorite Chinese state-run media, the Global Times, claimed this exposed the United States' dependence on China's rare earth products. The US was already talking about this two presidents ago.
This case involves something called rare earth materials, which are used by American manufacturers to make high-tech products like advanced batteries that power everything from hybrid cars to cell phones. We want our companies building those products right here in America. But to do that, American manufacturers need to have access to rare earth materials, which China supplies.
You know, on the one hand, it's reassuring to hear that Western leaders recognize the threat this poses to their economies and national security. But on the other hand, it's been 10 years since that speech, and everyone is still so dependent on China. In 2020, the US imported 78% of its rare earths from China, which is risky because we've seen the Chinese Communist Party use rare earths as a political weapon. In 2010, China stopped rare earth exports to Japan over a territorial dispute. This disrupted Japan's automotive industry, led to global price spikes, and generated a global rush to secure supplies. And if you think, well, that was more than 10 years ago, a lot has changed since then, let me remind you that China started a trade war with Australia after it called for an investigation into the origins of COVID. The Chinese Communist Party often uses trade to make other countries bow to its will. And it's already threatened to use rare earth elements as a bargaining chip. In 2019, Xi Jinping made a visit to a rare earth magnet factory in Jiangxi province. A few days later, an editorial by state-run Xinhua News warned that by waging a trade war against China, the United States risks losing the supply of materials that are vital to sustaining its technological strength. Hu Xijin, the former editor-in-chief of the Global Times, claimed that the government was seriously considering weaponizing exports of rare earth elements to the US. Now, the answer to this problem may seem simple: find new sources of rare earths. The problem is that's a lot easier said than done. Since that trade spat with China 12 years ago, Japan still hasn't managed to wean itself off China's rare earth elements. According to the Observatory of Economic Activity, Japan went from importing 74% of its rare earths from China in 2010 to 27% in 2020. While that's a big decrease, it's not yet zero. And believe me, Japan has tried hard to not give China that kind of leverage again. One obstacle to doing this is that while rare earths aren't as rare as, say, gold, what is difficult is finding them in large enough quantities to make mining profitable. I mean, it's just so much cheaper to just buy them from China. Then there's the costly and environmentally hazardous process of refining them. This is Baogang Tailings Dam in China's Inner Mongolia region. Thanks to rare earth mining and processing, it's now a lake full of toxic sludge. This is why China owns so much of the market. Who wants to deal with lakefuls of hazardous waste? This is why Western countries like to outsource this to China, which has cheap labor and very few environmental regulations. Out of sight, out of mind, right? China also leads the market because its biggest producers of rare earths are owned and subsidized by the state. State-owned producers were currently dialed up production and flooded global markets with cheap supplies to drive out for-profit Western competitors. Yes, nothing like good old market manipulation to press your competitive advantage. Unfortunately, the demand for rare earths is only growing around the world, which means the West is still very much dependent on China. That's because newer green technology, like wind turbines and electric vehicles, use even more rare earths than older forms of technology. And so the problem is just going to get worse. This is why the US and its allies are scrambling to come up with new sources. And they're looking everywhere you can imagine. More on that after the break. Welcome back. China owns a big share of the rare earths market, and that gives it a lot of leverage because they're essential to modern technology. But China's grip on the market might not last much longer. From 98% of global mined production in 2010, China's market share had fallen to 58% by 2020. That's largely due to China's own mistakes. Ever since China banned rare earth exports to Japan over a territorial dispute and a price hike in 2011, Japan and its allies have been trying to limit their reliance on China. Countries have been investing in their own rare earth mines, as well as the mines of their allies, a practice known as friendshoring, including Australia, Canada, the US, and the EU. China's control of the market, along with the cost and environmental issues, have pushed countries to look for alternatives. But there's more going on, and this is where China may see its grip on the market really slipping. Researchers at the University of Cambridge have discovered a way to make hard magnets without using rare earth metals at all. They found a way to produce tetratiunite, an alloy of iron and nickel, which can replace magnets made from rare earths. Tetratiunite is found on meteors, but researchers say it can be replicated in a lab in a matter of seconds. Not only is it a lot cheaper to produce, but it also doesn't come with the same environmental problems as mining does. And the main bonus is that it doesn't have to come from China. Although if it does go commercial, I'm sure China will try to steal that technology and sell it to us even cheaper. The president of a technology consultancy company told NPR that it's one of the most interesting things I've seen in the rare earth space, and I look at a dozen of these sorts of discoveries a week. 99.9% of them will never become commercial. This one actually might. Researchers are also working on refining rare earths from coal ash, mining them in the ocean, and even someday mining them in space. But analysts still expect it to take years for the West to wean itself off China's rare earths. And China Uncensored is able to keep making episodes like this because of viewers like you, which is why it's time for me to answer a question from a China Uncensored viewer who's part of the 50 Cent Army. It's a group of fans who support us through Patreon or Locals. Today's question comes from Ian Pendleton on Patreon. What do you think would happen to all the artificial islands China made in the South China Sea if the CCP were ever forced to abandon them? Would they be left to be reclaimed by nature? Or would the other competing nations want to take them over and use the islands as bases for their own armed forces? Spoils of war, Ian. Spoils of war. Whoever wins the war over Taiwan gets to decide what to do with the islands. I'm assuming, of course, that the Chinese Communist Party won't just abandon them for some reason. It's possible some of them will be given to neighboring countries who have territorial claims like Vietnam, Malaysia, or the Philippines. Ideally, they would only use them the way Taiwan uses the one island it controls in the South China Sea. That one's called Taiping Island, or Ituabu. Taiwan uses it for search and rescue missions, as well as defending against a Chinese invasion. That could be the future of some of China's militarized islands. Or who knows, they might all get bombed into oblivion during the war. Thanks for your question, Ian. And thank you to everyone else who supports the show. Be like Ian and support China Uncensored by going to patreon.com/ChinaUncensored and contributing a dollar or more per episode. As one of the perks, you can ask me questions that I'll answer on the show. Once again, I'm Chris Chappell. See you next time.